Eric Mangini's joining us. Was there any... The late hit was a late hit. You're going to call that, especially with quarterbacks. Was there a call or anything that really bothered you in the Bengal Chief game?
Yeah, I didn't mind most of the calls that took place in that game. I thought there were, and the last two Bengals drives, there really was an opportunity to call roughing the passer, and neither one of them got called, which is interesting because that's the one focal point throughout the course of the season where we thought it was over-officiated.
Right.
And this game, it seemed like it was under-officiated. But as you said, if you leave it up to the officials, it's going to be a problem. And you preach that to your guys going into every game, but especially going into big games where they usually let you play more.
Yeah, no, so that's an interesting point. So we've been saying this for years. One of the reasons in the NBA that veteran teams usually win in the playoffs, because the further you go in my lifetime, NBA playoffs, by the time you get to conference championships, they're swallowing a lot of whistles. And that helps the physically, you know, the NBA veteran 32 has been in a weight room for 11 years. And those veteran guys can manipulate refs. They lean on you. So I always felt basketball, longer the playoff goes, less whistles. You felt that as an NFL coach. Playoffs, they're going to let more go.
Yeah, you know, Bill Belichick always would say, we're going to do business as business is being done, and you see how the game is going to go. And look, our first Super Bowl against the Rams, we beat up those wide receivers. We beat up those skill guys. And as we beat them up and they didn't get called, we went up and beat them up some more because that's the way the game was going to go. And the officials don't want to be the reason that the game is won or lost. So when they're in doubt, typically they're not going to throw that flag.
Yeah. I want to talk. Let's talk about Philadelphia. It's a unique franchise. Is that generally, if you look at a dynasty, Patriots, you have one coach and one quarterback. Philadelphia's fired guys like Doug Peterson, who won a Super Bowl with Nick Foles. Chip Kelly had a winning record. They've had four coaches, 23 years, three to the Super Bowl. They do it a little differently in Philadelphia. They're not beholden to history. I find it refreshing. 90% of the things they do, I initially blanch and go, what are we getting rid of Carson Wentz for? How are they viewed in the league, though? How do you look at Philadelphia?
I look at them with a lot of respect because they take some chances that other teams don't take on some guys that may have struggled from a character perspective. They've done that in the past. They'll make moves on head coaches to get a different voice in the building, and they've been successful with that. And even the Carson Wentz move, they ate more dead money than anybody had eaten at that point in the NFL. And it takes a lot to say, hey, we made a mistake, but instead of living with this mistake and compounding it, we're going to move on and go in a different direction. That's hard to do, especially when you're talking about the numbers they ate with Carson.
Philadelphia has just got better units across the board, and Philadelphia is better. That's my takeaway. What's yours on the Super Bowl?
Well, it's going to be interesting. I think Jalen Hurts is going to have to play better than he played this past week. And the quarterback-driven runs weren't really that effective by any stretch. He had one drive where he had a little bit of effectiveness, but not what we've been used to seeing from him. It's going to be interesting with the way that they can generate pass rush. That's going to be a problem for Kansas City because of Mahomes' mobility issue. And then running the football. They've been effective at running the football. They've got a pretty creative running game. Now, some of that, or a decent amount of that, stems from how effective Jalen Hurts is. But Kansas City could struggle with that. And if if Philly can control the game through the running game, That's going to be a problem for Mahomes and the Chiefs.
You know the San Francisco organization well. You spent some time there, and I was watching the game in about the third quarter, and I'm sitting there thinking, so Kyle had Trey Lance hurt, Garoppolo hurt, Purdy hurt, Josh Johnson hurt. And, you know, circumstances change, and it changes your perception. And I thought, I could see Kyle on that flight home telling John, can you just get me a big, strong guy who can give me 17 games? I can't go through this roller coaster because McCaffrey's been dinged. Debo's been dinged. Kittle's been dinged. Trent. The window here is not open forever. Now, the defense has some young stars, but this offense is aged. Do you think they just come back with Purdy and let it rip?
look, Colin, their whole quarterback process has been up and down. They get Trey Lance. They want to move on from Jimmy. They can't move on from Jimmy. They redo his contract. They luck out there. Jimmy gets hurt. They've got Purdy, who's Mr. Irrelevant. There's you can't tell me that they were sitting thinking, okay, this guy can come in and do what he did. There's no chance they thought that. But he does, and then you go into the game like this, and your backup is a guy who's been with 10 different NFL teams and has only started 9 games, and he's 1-8 in those starts. And there's no answer after him. So it's been all over the place, and they've lucked out in a lot of ways. It's going to be interesting to see whether or not they really feel that Purdy is the guy, or do you take a swing with Tom Brady for a year and think, okay, Purdy is our future, and what a great mentor to have for him for 1 year.
You know, I said this before, Bill Russell had 11 titles, Jordan had 6, but very quickly we were able to go, Jordan's better. And I know Brady's more productive, but I could argue Mahomes can do virtually everything Tom can do. There's a lot Tom can't do that Mahomes can do, and I don't care about titles. I don't think I've ever seen a player with this level of instinct, talent, arm angles. He's just, Eric, it's different. He made a throw in the end zone where he literally, the minute he saw the player, the ball's out of his hands, and I'm like, I don't even know how you teach Mahomes. I mean, you were with Brady forever. What do you make of Mahomes?
It is different because typically quarterbacks that can move around like Mahomes can't throw like Mahomes. And he gets out of the pocket, and when he gets out of the pocket, those broken plays are big plays, but he can sit in the pocket and kill you too. I'd say the difficulty he's going to have with catching Tom Brady is as time goes on, his mobility is going to decrease significantly, and you're going to have to see big jumps as a pure pocket passer as he continues to age. But as a overall skill set and a confidence level and an ability to make the people around him play better, it's really impressive.
I'm going to rip the Band-Aid off with Aaron Rodgers. I think actually Green Bay's roster, if they could get a first-round pick, they could address, and they historically drafted very well, they could use an edge rusher, another tight end. They could address both in the first round. I think it's rip a Band-Aid off time. Usually when you're moving off a legend, you got to scramble in the building. If Jordan can play, I think they're kind of uniquely set up to be competent next year. Would you rip the Band-Aid off with Aaron?
Well, look, if you thought Brett Favre was being backed up by Aaron Rodgers and you move on to Aaron Rodgers, and that's a great situation. Is Jordan Love that equivalent for Aaron Rodgers that Aaron was for Brett Favre? I don't know if that's true, but I do know this, as frustrating as Aaron can be and the challenges that he presents, I would happily spend hours talking to him about his off-season adventures and all those things and deal with any annoyance as opposed to dealing with a quarterback situation that wasn't very good. I've been through that. And look, we see organizations going through it now, whether it's the Colts, New Orleans, take your pick. When you lose a great quarterback, if you don't have a guy like that in the building to potentially give you what he gave, then you live with the frustration for as long as you can. Otherwise, you're going to be really sad when you're playing against them.
Are you in Cleveland today?
I am in New York City today.
Oh, are you on First Things First?
First Things First.
Oh, there you go. Well, boy, he's going to be what a joy Nick Wright's going to be today.
He won't. He doesn't gloat, which is nice about Nick. He never,
very gracious as a winner.
Very understated.
Yes, as always. Great seeing you, Coach. Thanks. Hi, everybody. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from The Herd or go watch a few segments from other shows on FS1.